building something in our life. Whether it's with somebody, somebody else. But what Christ said is he wants us to build our life upon him. And this is the part where it says, I will not be shaken. When we build our life upon Jesus Christ, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. But if we build it upon something else, if we build upon ourselves, we build it upon somebody else, we build it upon a job, we build it upon whatever that we build our life upon, can I tell you this? It's going to crumble down. Some point, sometime, it will crumble. And who do you have? You have whoever you put your foundation in. And if you put your foundation in Jesus Christ, through anything that you go through, you will have who? Jesus Christ. He is and should be always our firm foundation. So let's go, Lord, in prayer before we get started this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, and as we'll be reading your passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Lord, I pray that you would guide our hearts and our mind. Lord, there's going to be some things that we're going to find in our life that we are immature in. And then there's going to be things that we find ourselves mature in. And Lord, you want us mature in you. You want us to have our foundation in you and to be mature in you, not to be running around immature in Jesus Christ. Because there are consequences in our life here, and there's consequences in our life in heaven for not being mature in you. Guide us, direct us this morning. May you move with your Holy Spirit. May you protect these walls from all evil. And Lord, may we be able to concentrate on what you'd have for us this morning. We ask this in your name, and all God's people said. Amen. So take your Bibles, if you have them this morning, and go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We'll start off there. Has anybody ever had a storage unit? How many have a storage unit? Okay, and what is it for? Anybody can tell me? Probably what? 80% of it, yeah. 80% of it could be labeled as junk, and then the other 20 is. Some of it's pretty good. Some of it you do put away, and you're like, oh, where did I put that? And then have you ever, like, forgot that you had it? And you're like, where is that? I know it's somewhere. And then it was where? Hidden in the storage shed or storage unit or downstairs somewhere in a box, and you had it. And so this morning's message, what I want it to be related to is just this, is that we have in our life a storage unit. And a lot of times what we do is we take God and we actually put God in a storage unit. He is telling us that we need to live a certain way, act a certain way, be a part of life in this way, and then we take our life and we like put it away, like, okay, not now, God, I'm just going to put it in this storage, and then when I get around to it, then I'll come back. And have you ever done that? Like, you know, when you come in there and you're like, where is this thing? And you have to tear apart all these boxes because you can't remember where it was. Maybe you didn't label it, you know, and even if you did label it, sometimes someone else got a hold of it and put something else in there that you labeled something, and you're like, oh, this is supposed to be Christmas, and it's Halloween, or it's, you know, the list could go on what it is. God has these things that he wants in our life, and he's not organizing your life. He's allowing you to make decisions for him, like not for him, but with him. And so he is, if we give our life, truly give it to him, he does organize our life, and he puts things in perspective. But if we don't do that, if we're not giving our life to him and giving that on this foundation and building our life upon that, can I tell you this? You're going to find yourself in these boxes, and we're looking for you. We can't find you because you're misplaced. And it's not God that misplaced you. It's you that misplaced yourself by not following God's way. And in life that happens, right? Have you ever done that? Like, you're having someone come and help you. It's so difficult to say, can you come and help me organize my stuff? Right? And then people who are like, I'll come and help you. Like, anybody want any help? You can tell my wife, because probably 80% of it goes into the dumpster. And she's like, because she has no attraction or attachment to it. But for those of us that have these attachments to it, right, it's like, she's like, oh, well, you know, what about this? No, you know, you take it, I want it back here. You put it right, and it's like nice and neat. No, not really. It's, and then you go back once a year, maybe you come back, oh, I'm going to open it up and look at it, you know. And then we just carry all these things. God wants to organize in a way that we're on target. We're not putting things away going, well, what about that, God? No, God just wants us to move forward. He doesn't want us to go backward and pull things out in our life that maybe, you know, yeah, okay, it affected us in this way or affected us in that way. And sometimes it affects us good. Sometimes it affects us bad. And a lot of times we take this good and we want to go back to this good because we're in a life situation that's not going so well. And so we look and we go, well, what about back there? I want to go be back in there. I want to be here. And so then we sit all the time thinking about what it was like there when God wants to be with us here and he's trying to teach us what is in his plan for you today. And so this morning I want us to look at this part of life that is to be living with Jesus Christ. When you come to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you become married. Now, okay, we got a whole bunch of teens here, and they're not married yet. How many have been married? How many are still married? Oh, yeah. All right. And I knew that was there. And so then, and those that have been married, you're going to be following this as well. Because you understand the part that you got married. Why did you get married? And I don't want you to go to the bad parts. I want you to go to the good parts, okay? Why did you get married in the first place? Not now, not through all of this. Why did you get married in that first place? And this is the relationship that we're to have with Jesus Christ. We are married with Jesus Christ. And the relationship that we're to have with him is this a beautiful relationship. And he will rule and reign in your life, but he is a giving God. He is giving to us. He wants you to learn different things. He's not one who like overpowers you and goes, you can't be yourself. You have to I know I created you this way, but we're going to change you. No. He created you to be a certain way. And maybe someone else can't stand you, but God loves you. All right? Right? And so, and here, and the part of it is that it's okay. It's all right. As long as we're not doing it on purpose to irritate somebody, right? God made us a certain way. We all choose and have friends, different friends, because based on we get along with them. Amen? We're not just friends with everybody. I mean, we try to be in Christ, right? But we have certain friends that, okay, yeah, we get along with them because we're on a similar page. But if we're opposite, it's not going to work. But that doesn't mean that they don't have friends, right? And it doesn't mean that you don't have friends and can't have friends. But here's the crazy thing about Christ. He's not trying to change your character, maybe trying to change your character in a better manner, but he's not changing you as personality character, you know, that's what I'm looking at. He's not trying to change that. He's trying to just transform you and lift your spirits in him and take you from your flesh into a spiritual realm to where life is good. Whether it's bad, whether you have some bad things going on or whether you have good things going on, it is good in Jesus Christ. And if we can live in that moment, if we can live there, that is the best moment of our lives, is living in Jesus Christ, who is our firm foundation. What does that mean? If it's firm, it's not moving, right? It's not moving. So let's get started. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm going to read here. But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now you are not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not being merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered. But God gave the growth, so neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field and God's building. So I'm going to look first here in the first part of this, and it says, but I, brothers, cannot address you as spiritual people. What is Paul saying here? He comes to the church and he says, hey, I'm coming to you, but I can't come to you and look at you and go, you're a spiritual people. Now, would you not want that to have happen? When someone comes through those doors, we want someone to come in here and go, you know what? That church, there was something different about that church. I feel this love that come when you come in the door. I feel that I'm not like looked at and persecuted for the way I dress or talk or walk, whatever it is. You come in, you feel the love. Not just that, then you feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit. See, when we come to church, we need to be convicted, amen? We need to feel that the Holy Spirit is doing the work and wants to change us, and he does. But if we're not preaching the Word of God, if we're not teaching the Word of God, then you will never hear about that in your life. I can scratch you here and itch you here. I won't itch there. And then, you could do different things, right? But and make you feel good. But what does that do? If I'm trying to make you feel good and I'm trying to go like, well, wait a second, I'm going to build this church upon making you feel good. Well, that's not what a church is about. A church is about coming and feeling who? Jesus Christ. Knowing that Jesus Christ is trying to change me. When I come through those doors, I want to be changed. I'm coming to be changed. And I want to learn more about Jesus Christ. Does that make sense? So when we come, some people come and they're like, well, wait a second, I came because I wanted to worship. And they didn't play my song this morning. I'm sorry, we didn't play your song this morning. But we still can find fellowship and we can still find a praise and worship through what? The songs that are played. Because why? Christ, if we are trying to lift Christ up, it's not that we're choosing the songs that's making us lift them up. We're coming with that behavior, that idea that, you know what? What is there for me today, I'm going to lift Jesus Christ up. No matter what it is, I'm going to lift him up in my spirit. And when we do that, when we lift Christ up, what does he do? He changes our heart. He changes our mind. And he changes our momentum and takes our flesh from us, the things that we want. Well, this church was not being spiritual in the aspect that he even said that they are what? They are babes. Doing what? Drinking milk. Now, if I pass out a bottle to everybody here, you would be like, oh, that's weird. Okay? So we're not going to have donuts. We're not going to have any bread, no dough. You guys are going to drink a bottle today, and it's going to be in a bottle. And I want everybody, to drink out of this bottle. And you'd be like, I'm not doing that. Like, you are not. And then someone would be like, yeah, I'm for it. I'll try anything. And then, but it feels awkward. So I'm putting this into the category of this in looking and saying, okay, how would you like it if God came to you and said, you know what, your spiritual level is as a child. Here. Now walk around today with this in your mouth. And everybody that sees you, they're like, well, why are you walking around with a bottle stuck in your mouth and you're drinking?
Yeah, that's my new way of drinking shake. But it's really not. It's you just don't want to tell them that, hey, this is my spiritual reality with God. I'm on an infant level, and I can't get to the real meat because I'm still in this infant area. I'm just not mature in Christ. And then God's saying, what can I do to get you to that level? What can I get you to change your part of this milk to having meat? What can I do? And Paul's doing this, is I just have to preach louder than them downstairs, right? And so here it is that we have to get out of the milk. Milk is good. When you are a baby, it is good. You don't just take a ham steak and give it to a baby and say, here, go gnaw on this, right? It's not going to work. And they can't get the right protein because they don't have the teeth. If it gets in their stomach, they're going to get sick because it's still building, right? They're still building. They're still maturing. They're still getting to the point where possibly they can't. When I was, mom had a picture, and I remember sitting on my grandpa's lap, and he gave me a turkey bone and mashed potatoes, and then she picked up a picture that had my sister on there, and I thought it was me, but it was my sister. And so verified by Vicky, because she said my nose is a little bit longer than hers, and anyway. So it was Donna. Anyway, and so where am I going with this? Anyway, so then this turkey deal, and we're there sitting there. When I was wanting and longing to eat at the table with everybody, I don't want the little chewed up piece. When I got to that point, I was like, man, I want a turkey bone. I mean, I want some mashed potatoes. I want something that stays in my stomach, and I'm not like an hour later going, wow. Want more, right, Mom? And I was like, come on, Mom, knocking on it. Give me more, I want more, I want more. And finally, Grandpa Shanahan, he's like, just give them to me. Bam. Sticks in. Oh, it was so good. That was the best Thanksgiving ever. And so I remember those things. But my body was just mature. When you are young in Christ, when you are maturing in Christ, you need to have some of the things that need to be taught about who Christ is. How is it that Christ died for you? You need to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, right? You must know. The Bible says you must know that you know. Because how is it that you can stand against the wiles of Satan without knowing? He is coming at you and going, are you sure you're a Christian? Are you sure you know Jesus Christ? Are you sure you're born again? You know, and all these things, and you need to know from Scripture that you learn as a babe. John 3:16, Romans 3:23, Romans 6:23, Romans 10:9, 8 and 10, Ephesians 2:8 and 9. You need to know these things. You need to know them in your head. You need to know them in your heart. You know, yes, I put my faith and trust in who? Jesus Christ, Him alone. And what happens is then your maturity, then you start to grow. Well, how do you grow? You grow through what? Reading God's Word. The more you can read of God's Word and the more you can allow the Holy Spirit to guide you through that, to help understand it, then the more you will mature. And here's another way that he says. He says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, especially as the end days are coming and we are here in the end days. Hey, Paul said it back then, we were in our end days. How much closer are we now? Yes? To the end days. Hey, you can see it. Australia had the fire of what? Never? What are these things that are going on in our world today? Floods and all the things. Earthquakes. Hey, there was another earthquake. Just last year, it was a five, and they were going, this is the biggest ever. Well, guess what? They just had the biggest one. 6, I think it was. Incredible. We're seeing things. What is it? This is a sign. God's saying, hey, wake up, people. I'm coming. And you only have today. Maybe. We don't know. Hey, the trumpet could sound right now, right? And we'd all be gone. That would be awesome, wouldn't it? But there's still those that are in need of Jesus Christ, right? There are still those that are even say they're Christians who are missing the boat. They're not here today. Because they're choosing to be somewhere else. They're not in a church, not just here. They're not in a church somewhere because they're choosing not to be in that church. They're choosing not to be there because they are not wanting to learn about God and who Jesus Christ is in their life. when you mature in Christ, you are wanting to learn more about who God is. What is he about? What does he want your life to be like? What does he want to change in your life? Last week we talked about it, right? How do you understand God? By the Holy Spirit. And then when you read the Word of God, what does it say that the Holy Spirit does? When you read the Word of God and you ask for what? Guidance and wisdom. What does he say he gives to you? Guidance and wisdom. The more you learn about that, hey, there's going to be some things that you read in there that's confusion. I'm going to tell you what. When I first read Proverbs, I was like, huh? And I read over, and then I read it again. And then I'm like, what? Like, this is like, man. What's the poet that we always have to read that's either in college, okay, or high school? Shakespeare. Oh, man. And then when the teacher says, could you write what this is saying? Nope. Yeah, exactly. And then I get an F because I wrote what I thought it meant. And I'm like, okay, this is what I thought it meant. Well, she says what? Or he says what? This is not what it meant. You told me to write what I thought it was. And so these things are that I have no help, right? I have no help unless I went to somebody who could help me understand what this phrase meant, what this word meant. I just went in there and I was reading it and going, writing out whatever it was. I didn't ask anybody for help. Well, that's why I got the bad grade in Shakespeare. But when you ask the Holy Spirit, because you have the Holy Spirit, if you know Jesus Christ, your Savior, then you have the Holy Spirit. You ask the Holy Spirit to help you understand. I can guarantee you this, you will start to understand the Word of God. Because he will send certain people in your life. He'll also just guide you. All of a sudden you're like, oh yeah, that's where that verse is, and that connects to this, and that connects to this, and you start to learn. But if you are not involved in Bible studies, if you're not involved in church, if you're not involved in something deeper, then you are having a difficulty maturing in Jesus Christ. There is such a thing as people who will stay home and stay home continually and go, well, I can get it on TV. I'm going to tell you, yes, you can get somewhat of God in at home watching it on TV, but you cannot get it through fellowship at all. And you will never get in fellowship. And what ends up is they turn into this hermit that stays in a bottle, and that's all they do is stay in the home. They don't recognize anybody. And how is it that Christ can use that person to reach somebody else if they just stay in a home? They can't. God is unable to use that person unless they get out amongst the people, right? We have to rub shoulders with some people that we may not want to rub shoulders with. But what does that do? It spreads Jesus Christ. The focus is not on people, the focus is on Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is focused on who? People. How is it that he can change you? How is it that he can all of a sudden you set yourself and you go, wow, suddenly I feel like doing this for somebody. How is that? Who does that? God does that. Christ does that. I'm not saying that the fire, you know, the fire that happened in Australia, there's many, many people that are sent. Many people feel this urge to go and do what? Help and bring about the animals and take care of these things. I'm not saying that that's not part of God's plan in that. I'm saying that God's plan is to reach souls for Jesus Christ. And when we give our hearts to Christ, when we are following him the way we are supposed to in a marriage, which we're going to have somebody come up here in a little bit, and I'm going to do like a little play, drama, whatever it is, and hopefully it works out the way I'm hoping it does. I think you're going to catch what we do with God. I think you're going to catch that it is very important for us to make our decisions through Christ. Because if we stop making our decisions through Christ, then what are we making it through? We're making it through our flesh. And how does that work out? We know how that works out, right? We already know that. So what is going to help in making us in 2020 make the right decisions in Jesus Christ? What's going to help is you're going to see through when we do this drama. Let's read on just a little bit farther, though, before we start this, before we do the drama. Because it's just drama. No, I'm just kidding. So what's the next verse? Put the next verse up there. 1 Corinthians 4:15. Is that up? Let's do that. For though you have countless guides in Christ, you do not have many fathers. For I became your father in Christ Jesus through the gospel. This is what he's telling the church. He says, for though you have countless guides in Christ, what is a guide? Anybody ever go hunting and get a guide? So Mike, were you happy about having a guide? If he wasn't drunk, but... Okay, having the right guide is very, very important. Because the reason why I picked on Mike, because he told me. Anyway, you talk to him about his experience with that. But having the right guide is very important. And so in 15 it says this, for though you have countless guides in Christ, you do not have many what? What is a father? What do you look as a father to? What is a father supposed to do for you? Let's just name what some of the things a father is supposed to do. One thing. Okay, one at a time. Teach. A father is supposed to teach us and teach us correctly, right? Okay, what else? Marcus? Teach us how to learn. That is really good. Because if we're not able to learn, then how do you learn life? How do you learn how to do something? So great, Marcus. Mike?
Protection.
Very, you know, when you come to your father, you want to feel protected, not what? Oh, get to your room. You know, I know you had this terrible nightmare, but just get to your room. You'll be fine. Don't worry about it. Anybody have something where you have a fear episode? You go to your dad and your dad's like, whatever, didn't affect me. Get on with your life. Toughen up. Just toughen up, right? Protection. You want to feel that you're protected. I remember going off a slide. So I'm going to go off a rabbit here. I remember going off a slide, very young. Going down the slide, I didn't want to do it. Dad's down there, going to take care of me, right? I'm like, I don't want to do this. I come down the slide. Whew. Whoops. And there I go. Boom. And all I remember is going down and sinking. And going, is he ever going to get me? And I'm going to tell you what, that is the life that I lived. But with my Father in heaven, I never had that. I never had that. My Father in heaven always got me. Well, how did I learn how to become a father? Through what? The Word of God. You cannot become a good mother or a good father without this right here. Without knowing this right here. And this is what it's saying. It says, for though you have countless guides in Christ. Hey, I can point you the right way. I can point. Hey, I can point. Hey, I can do it. Hey, I can do it. Hey, can you? Are you mature enough? Are you really following God? Are you walking around with a bottle in your mouth and saying that you're good? Or have you moved into the Word of God where you know about the Word of God? You know, not everything. I'm going to tell you, the truth is you're never going to know everything about the Word of God. But as you are learning and trying and doing your best to get the Word of God in and taking, reading it, study, whatever it is, coming to a Bible study, when you put that in motion, guess what happens to the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit is also set in motion. We learned that from last Sunday. That the Holy Spirit wants to give you. You just have to go, wait a second. I didn't quite understand this, so the Holy Spirit, guide me through this. Hey, you're going to go to a Bible study, and you're going to be like, I was lost tonight. Or you're going to be like, that was awesome tonight. But if you're lost in it, just go to the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, just help me to concentrate a little more. Help me to get this. You know, give me another verse. Help this all tie together. When you do that, what does the Bible say? The Bible says, I will give you what? Read 1 Corinthians 2. I'm telling you, right in the middle there. It says it. The Holy Spirit will guide you. Will give you wisdom of that. But we are so much involved in our flesh that we're not going to our Heavenly Father and saying, teach me how to be a good father. Teach me how to be a good mother. Teach me how to be a great, great grandparent. And will He? Yes, He will. He will. And that's what Paul's saying. He's like, listen, countless guides, countless. But what? You do not have many fathers. Let's just go, you don't have many mothers. Hey, when I want to come to my father, I want to come to a father who knows, who's going to help me. If I'm coming to my mother, I want to know that my mother is going to help me spiritually. Not just that physical part, but that mental part, that spiritual part that's guiding and directing me to what matters in life. Yes? It matters in life. Hebrews 5:10-14. Being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek, about this we have much to say. And it is hard to explain since you have become what? Dull of hearing. You ever done that with your child? Are you listening to me? Hey, my wife does that to me all the time. Are you listening to me? What? What'd you say? Dull of hearing. Dull of hearing of what? Dull of hearing the word of God. Yes? That's what it's saying. For though by this time you ought to be what? You ought to be teachers. You need someone to teach you again. The basics. So 10 years later, we're sitting back in church. We come back to church, and our life hasn't matured in Christ. And then here's the pastor. Open up. Open up. Open up. Open up. You ever see that Bugs Bunny? Unbelievable. The factory of, you know, bottles. Maybe I'm just going because I remember Bugs Bunny was an awesome show. And then it had too much violence. I don't understand that one. Anyway, so here we go. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles, the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. Hey, this is a pastor's nightmare. 10 years from now, we all come back and I'm starting all over again. We should be starting all over again with new believers, new classes, bringing them in. You should be the part where you're now teaching those believers, the new believers, because you're at the part where you're teaching them, because at 10 years from now, you should be there. You should be cutting the steak, and you're going, oh, here's a bottle. I remember being back then. I remember being in that way. Hey, there's nothing wrong with a bottle. Yes, there isn't. But when it's given to the right person, right, it's okay. The baby wants a bottle. And every one of you enjoys bottle feeding what? A baby. It's so cool, isn't it? To hold a baby in your arms, stick a bottle in there. And they're going, they go, it's awesome. It is cool, right? But it's not so cool when you're constantly giving someone a bottle. It's not so cool. You know, Cecilia, even though she wants to lay on mom's lap, she's just not going to get the bottle like she wants, right? But she's going to get meat and potatoes. And we sit down at the table. We're not giving her a bottle anymore. That's the way it is in the realm of doing God's work, that we should be growing. Every year you should be maturing in Christ. In Christ. And you're weaning off of the bottle and going to the meat and potatoes of God's word. Going beyond just salvation. Going into what? Teaching others. Being able to teach others. Praying in a way that you're praying for others. And you don't have to be coerced into prayer. You're just praying. Is maturity in Christ. At verse 13 it says, for everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the what? Mature. For those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from from evil. See, when someone comes to you, you want to come to somebody in the church. If you're having issues, you're like, I wonder if this is good for me to do. Don't you want to go to somebody who is mature in Christ and ask that question? Or do you want to go to somebody who is immature in Christ and then they give you the answer that you want because it lifts your flesh up? Because, yeah, you agree with me, right? It's awesome. We all agree here. But in reality, the Holy Spirit, that's not the agreeable answer with the Holy Spirit. Because we can all say that we can teach, but can we? When you are following God, it's not the matter that, it's not the matter of, well, I'm not ready to teach. I'm not. If we waited for teachers to step up the plate till they got a doctorate degree, then we never have a teacher. That's not what God is talking about. He's talking about, are you willing to learn? You know, the greatest thing to become is a teacher. Honestly, the more that you're digging in, it's that you now have to dig in to the Scripture. And listen, if you're teaching and you're not digging in the Scripture, then don't teach. Because that's not right. You should be concerned on whether or not you're giving food, giving something that they can get. Well, how come you don't understand, you know, 14 times 14 equals what? Only one of you said that? How dare, can you believe, you guys don't know what 14 times 14, I can't believe this. Hey, we have teachers that are doing that. They're looking at the Word of God and going, you don't understand the Word of God. Do you know how many times I have sat here and taught this? You just don't understand. You know, oh my word, get a break. What are they doing this for? Are we doing this so that we can help the immature become mature? That's what we're trying to do, right? That's the pastor's heart. The pastor's heart should be taking all of you, immature and mature, and bringing you to a maturity in Christ. And I can do it on levels. I have to do it on different levels. I can do it in a story here or there. And it's not that I'm trying to stomp on toes. It's that I'm lifting you up so that you can become mature in Christ. See, the Holy Spirit's the one that stomps on my toes when I'm up here preaching. And he's stomping on your toes or your head, because maybe you're sitting, you know, and got your toes covered underneath there. But if you ever feel like something's stomping on it, look to the Holy Spirit. He's guiding, he's leading, he's directing. Let's go to the next verse. Psalms 119, 103. Psalms 119, 103. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than the honey to my mouth. How many like honey? I love honey. I love it. I just pour it in my coffee. And I love honey. Do we look at the Word of God as something that's sweet like that? So when we break it open, do we look at it and go, wow, that was sweet? Even though it cut to your heart, do you look at it as it was sweet? That's what this verse is saying. We need to be at that point. We need to be at that point. At this time, I'm going to ask the Miss Belair to come up here. I asked her just before the service, and I asked her this. So this is Miss Belair. This is Addie. So here is life, and I want us to just kind of go away. I'm going to put this drama into place, and I'm hoping it goes the way I'm hoping it goes, because I know Addie. It should go the way I'm hoping. So I'm just going to act as though I'm not married, okay? I am married. I'm married to Vicky over here, okay? But I'm gonna do this. I am married, and so I'm not cheating this morning. I am not, but I'm going to use Addie as an example. As what it is in life and how that we get confused, all right? So Addie has been praying for a husband. She has been praying for, I don't know if she's been praying, but she's been praying for a husband. She's been praying for a good husband. She's been praying for someone to follow the Lord. She's been praying for somebody that has a desire that she has to serve God, okay? She's been doing that. She's been praying this. And so lo and behold, she meets this guy who's not so good looking, but he's kind of cool. He's kind of cool. And so I'm the guy that's not so good looking and kind of cool. And so here we go. So I come up here, I'm like, whoa, Miss Belair. Woo! This is so awesome. There's no script, okay? There's no script. So this is ad lib. So and so I'm saying things that Addie probably would not be saying right now, but I'm gonna say it, okay? So, oh, he's awesome. And so then I'm like, hey, I'm going to marry Miss Belair. So I give her this ring, and I'm like, can you be my fiance? You know, and I do that on my knee. I'm like, my fiance. Like, give me. And then I get a ring, I put a ring on that left hand. And I go, and she's like, oh, this is so great. And then we go, and we're going to go see Pastor Dave. We're going to go get married. And so I'm standing up here, and we're up here, you know, and I'm like, do you know your dancer? Are you? I'm like, yeah. Get her. And then I go, they're married. And then here it is. Was that a fast trip or what? I pray it never goes that fast for any one of you. Date, really find out who they are. And this is the whole serious part of it. So Addie, in her life, and she's like, oh, you know what? He really was trying to. He went to church a few times. He was trying to follow God. He knows, wants to be part of God, whatever in life. And so things will change. It'll all change, right? And so Addie, let's go to dinner. Let's go to dinner. Will you go to dinner with me? All right, awesome. So we go down, we sit down, and we're like, honey, is it great? Great. And then Addie's like, go home. Can we have a devotion? Addie, come here for a second. Go right through here. Turn around, step, chunk, click. Whew, I'm over that one. I don't have to have a devotion. Do you want your Bible? Because we're not, this isn't good. Now, who's going to clean the house? Addie, okay, yeah, you know. No, yeah, okay. And then, hey, he wants me to pray for the kids. They go down. Addie, go back. Woo! You got to get rid of that one. That one's a big one, all right? Here we go. You know what? The kids need to eat. What? Oh, yeah, you know what to do. I'm going to go sports. Got the bar to go to. Go San Francisco. Woo! Go back. And then, I don't even know. Did San Francisco win? She goes, woo! Is she not trade? This is awesome. It's awesome. I didn't even have to lock it. It's locked. Woo! This is good. Is this a life to live? Is this a life that is involving a relationship? Yeah, okay, yeah. I'll bring her out. We're not having a relationship. We're having this, as long as you do what I want, and I'll give you, you can go out and hang out with the girls here and there, and you can go to church. But, when the kids get to a certain age and they want to decide on where they want to go, well, let them do it or I'm going to put you in the, Hey, if we're not on the same, we're on the same wavelength with Christ, God, then how is it? And that's what happens. It happens so quickly is that the person who is not following God is really putting them in a box and in a storage area. And you are unable to really be fulfilled in and out of that, right? So tell me, how does that make you feel? Like when I... Neglected. Awesome word. Neglected. I love it. Thank you, Addie. Give her a hand. And in our life, that's the same thing we're doing to Jesus Christ. I did it with this because we're... we're not married, but I did it as an example. And we separate the biblical stand here, the biblical end of things. And what happens is that we actually, we're married to Jesus Christ, and we do the same thing. Christ is calling out, and he says, hey, I want you to teach. Woo! Christ, get in there. No, not me. That's going to take, I got to study a little bit more. I got to be involved in the church. Like, it's, I might have to be there every week. I'm not sure if that kind of goes with my plan, God. What about like once a month? Well, that ain't working for a teacher because we need teachers. It ain't working with God, you know, but we'll put them out. And now, I got a problem. I got a problem. It's huge. I got to, where did I put Christ at? Here he comes. Wow, God, I need help in this area. I really need it. Will you help me? I promise I'll read 2 scriptures a day. God wants your heart. He wants to be involved with you every day in every decision that you make. And just as it doesn't work for an unequally yoked couple, and that means not race, it means in God. It means knowing Christ. Each one should know Christ and be following Jesus Christ. The hardest thing is this, for youth. The hardest thing to think about is there's another fish in the sea. Because when you're looking at the fish in the sea, how many see the fish in the sea from a distance? I've never, not unless it was like calm and you could actually see through down there and every once in a while you see one. But that doesn't mean the fish in the sea aren't there, right? How many fish of the sea are there? Oh, my word. When a whale opens up to get fed, the mouth, it said, like, how many of the shrimp does one, and what devours, unbelievable amount of shrimp comes in. Where was that shrimp? Hey, I imagine the sailors are like, I want to have that in my bank account. That's a lot of shrimp that just went down into a whale's tummy. And how many whales are there? Huge amount. Does not God supply for what? The whales? Every fish of the sea? The bird that flies through the air? Does he not supply for that? And listen to me. So when we think that Christ can't supply for your right mate, what are we doing for Christ? He's staying there. I'm going to go searching for, my way, because I can actually see him here. And he's okay. Oh, he prayed over his beer. That is awesome. I think that's the one for me. I'm telling you, you're in the wrong place. Get to the place where you're involved with God in your life. And that goes for singles out there as well that are adults. You get to a place with God. Let God do it. And you yourself follow Christ. You must mature in Jesus Christ. You understand that. Don't wait till you're married. Mature now. Because what happens is this. I'm going to tell you this as a matter of fact, not something that's fictitious. There is a man or there is a woman that is waiting for you that is going through the same situation that you're going through right now and searching for the right individual. And they are in the same situation where they're going, oh, well, that looks like it's godly. I think I'm going to go follow that person. They're doing the same thing that you are, but as long as you're following God and saying, nope, I want God in their life, and here's what I want to see happening down on, before I do this. When you wait, I can guarantee you this, God will put the person in your life. Can I say it again? If you wait. But if you're not willing to wait, then what will happen? He's in the closet. As much as we can say that we're following Christ, he's in the closet because we're choosing who we want based on what we feel is available. God's not into available. He's not into availability. He's into whether or not you're following Jesus Christ as your Savior. Do you know that there are marriages all over this world, all over churches, that if somebody would have just waited on the Lord instead of making a choice based on their choice, do you realize that? They would probably still be married today. or the problems that they faced it together because of Jesus Christ. Did you hear that? Can I tell you this? My wife and I would not be together if it wasn't for Jesus Christ.
Pastor,
I can't believe you just said that. I am born again. I know Jesus Christ is my Savior. Vicky is born again. She knows Jesus Christ is Savior. And we went through a rough spell. Went through a patch that I don't want anybody to ever go through. And because of Jesus Christ, our marriage was saved. The only way it was. But if I would have locked Jesus Christ up into that room, and if I would have said, I'm going to stay cold as Alaska in the middle of winter, and I am not moving, God. I will not come closer to you. Because I stayed in that area, if I stayed in that area, I can guarantee you I would not be with Vicky. I would not be standing here because I would not be married today. I would not be in a position that I could pastor. But I made a choice to allow the great Father of all fathers come back into and warm my heart of love and try to change me. Just try it, God. Well, he did. And he's still changing me. I'm going to tell you something. I am not perfect. People are like, what? I am not. Christ is perfect. And can I tell you this? Not one of you sitting here today is perfect, but Christ is perfect through you. Christ is perfect through you. And we become perfect in Christ. We become tolerable in Christ. I am tolerable because of Jesus Christ. But I can tell you this, if I'm intolerable, I'm not following Christ that day. Just talk to my family. Christ makes us tolerable. Christ makes us view life in a different aspect. Can you get that? And those of you that are mature in Christ, you're seeing yourself, right? You're seeing yourself mature. You're seeing yourself get to this point. Those of you are immature, you're going, whatever. This is a bunch of hogwash that pastors say. If you're immature in Christ, that's what you're feeling. And then you have to go, wait a second, I got light bulbs got to come on sometime. So God, can you make this happen faster than what I'm feeling? As soon as your light bulb comes on and you go, I am doing this by what? Faith, not by sight. I am doing it by, can we all say it? Faith, not by sight. I was at Heidi went out fishing, and they went fishing in the sea, and they went all over the place trying to catch what they wanted to catch, and they couldn't catch anything for a while, and then they finally started to catch things. If they could see where the fish were, then what? They would have caught it, but they can't see. Who's the only one that can see where all the fishes are? And the right ones, right? He knows everything. So that's why he tells us, don't worry about tomorrow. Worry about today. Worry about yourself following Christ, yourself following his way, not our way. And when we do this, you're going to find that these things just start building. Let's read on here in 1 Corinthians 3, and let's read verse 5. It says, what then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave what? The growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. I love this part. You must understand this. This is key, and we're going to close with this. This is key. There's more to go over, but this is it. This is key. In a body of believers in the church, we are all equal. Honestly, we are all equal. When you look at me, don't look at me as, whoa, he's like, way up there in this category, right next to God. No, I'm with you. I'm with you. I have been given the same amount of grace that each one of you has been given. Amen? And that grace is eternal life through Jesus Christ. It has nothing to do with what I am doing. It has everything to do with what Christ is doing. And what he wants to do is do a work through you, just like he's doing a work through me. And that's why he says this. He says, I did what? What did he say? What did he say in verse 15? He said what? I did what? I planted. Are we tilling? You can't just take seed. I've tried it. I've been like, you know what? Let's just skip all this tilling deal. And let's just throw the seed out and see what happens. Right? I mean, I'm like, what a waste of money. I mean, there's like a few came up. But I didn't take the weeds out. I didn't take the trees out. I didn't take the roots out. I didn't take, I just threw the seed out. I'm like, oh, now the deer will come. Woo! They didn't come. I had like a couple weeds and they ate it. They ate whatever did come up. It wasn't done right. You can't like jump the gun with Christ. You have to do this. You have to till. And what is it about tilling? How many love to get it behind the tiller? You ever do it? Especially those ones that just don't want to start. And you're like, boom, now it starts. Like, and you go, right? Awesome. Always kick it. Always hit it. Take a hammer. It works great. And then you just, you know, and get it going, right? And you're in the heat of the sun, and you're tilling out there one row at a time, one stone. And you're like, shut it down. Go in there and dig that out. You're like, man, these stinking rocks. Root, right? Another root. Oh, man, boom, boom. You get the axe. It takes work to till. I'm going to tell you this, that it takes work to study God's word. It takes work to stop and say, I'm going to a Bible study. I am not going to forsake going to a Bible study. I'm going to learn about God. I'm going to learn what I need to learn about God. I'm going to take time and I'm going to read the word of God. I'm going to study some passages. I'm going to get to know what the passage says, not just read it, but get to know what it says. I want to dig a little deeper into it. Hey, that's what it is about tilling the field. It's about tilling it. It's about working it. It's about sweating. We can't just skip through the tilling. The seed then can be what? So he said, what did he say? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave what? Hey, we need to do it together. And that's what the church is. And in Corinthians, we're talking about this. This is what Paul is telling us, that we need in each one of our lives to find Christ. Don't lock him up in a closet. Bring him out, a part of your life. Let him guide and direct you, lead you. And it takes work. Till it. Till your ground. And allow the seed as it's planted to what? What will the seed do? The Bible says it will not return what? Void. Hey, somewhere down the line, you ever go, man, arithmetic really stinks. Where am I going to use this in life? Until you find out when. And you're like, man, I'm glad I had that. It's the same with Christ. You got to till it. You got to want it. You got to want to allow the Holy Spirit to do the work in your life. And when you do it, and then that seed is planted, God's word is planted, the things will come up in your life. You will be blessed in a way that you're like, I'm not talking about this finance. Yes, in finances, he will do that. I'm talking about inside of you. You're going to have a relationship with somebody that you've been waiting for. He will show up. She will show up. Out of the blue. Because Christ knows who you need. If you're past that, you're already married and you're struggling and the things that are taking place in life, God says, I will be your father. I will be your husband. I'm telling you this is a fact. I know it. And the closer we get to God, he gives you those feelings, the comfort, the things that you need. And he allows you to be a part of him even deeper. Paul said, hey, if you cannot be married, didn't he say that? If you cannot be married, it's better for the ministry because you're not focused on other things. So there's good in all things with Christ. It's good. We just have to get him out of the closet and put him in our life. Activate him. He can't be active in your life if you're not allowing him to have a place in your life. Stand with me as we sing. And the choir doesn't have to come up. I don't really know this song very well.